Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How everybody feeling this morning? Amen. All right. Mr. Perry, what we come to do this morning? Come to celebrate. Yeah, celebrate life. Amen. What we doing, kids, on this morning? We celebrate. Amen. Praise God. Let us stand. But Aaron and his sons offered upon the altar of the burnt offering, and on the altar of incense, and were appointed for all the work of the place most holy, and to make an atonement for Israel, according to all that Moses, the servant of God, had commanded. Amen. Just read to you 1 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 49. Amen. We have prayer by Prophet Nixon.
Dear God, Heavenly Father, we come down before you, Lord. Just thank you, Lord God, for being in your presence on today.
All right. Praise the Lord on this morning. Praise the Lord on this morning. Oh yeah. Let's thank him on this morning. Yeah. Thank the Lord. Testimony service is now open to anybody that has a testimony.
I hear one kind of late, and I was just letting the Lord minister to me through this song, because you know it does get tough. But I thank him anyway.
Amen.
So I got a song this morning and help me sing it, because we are family and we're human.
You have to encourage yourself. Speak over yourself.
years to worship Him. How many of y'all desire years to worship Him? Yeah. To be more and more like Him. Each and every day, I lift my hand and say, I want to be more and more like Him.
Thank you.
songs enter into your spirit. So amen. Amen. Yeah.
Blessing and an honor
to be in the house of the Lord one more time. I thank God for everything he's done in the service so far. Thank God for DTG, Music Department, ushering in the presence of the Lord. He said he dwells in the midst of his praise. So when we're praising God in here, he's sitting right in the midst of us. So we were ready to receive the word of the Lord on today. It's going to be coming from 1 Samuel chapter 28. Verses 5 through 7. Before we go into the word, let us just pray over the word. Lord, we just thank you for the word.
We all pray.
Amen.
Amen.
1
Samuel chapter 28, verses 5 through 7. If you have it, give me a hearty amen.
Amen.
And it reads, and when Saul saw the host of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart greatly trembled. And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets. Then said Saul unto his servants, seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I may go to her and inquire of her. And his servants in the presence of the Lord. This saying simply means that if you mess with something or someone that is dangerous or harmful, you'll get hurt. One of the first lessons that an infant learns when they start walking, talking, and touching are what areas that are dangerous and what to stay away from. One of the first places they seem to want to put their hands on is a stove. And no matter how many times we tell them it's hot, no matter how many times we tap their hands, they still find a way to get to that stove and touch it. When they get a little older, we tell them not to run around or play in the house because they may fall, run into something, and hurt themselves. Then when they get old enough to play outside, we warn them to watch for cars. Don't talk to strangers, and the list goes on and on. What we're doing is helping them to understand that there is danger out there, so we have to set boundaries.
Amen.
We have to give rules. We have to make laws and guidelines to not only keep us out of trouble, but to protect us. In our text today, we have King Saul. He was faced with a problem that needed help, and he needed guidance. The Bible says that it came to pass in those days that the Philistines had gathered their armies together for warfare. They came up to fight against Israel. Now, King David was already with Achish and all of them doing his thing to fool the Philistines. So he's working behind the scenes and right in the enemy's camp. Now, Saul, when he heard that the Philistines had came to attack, he got afraid. And that's the problem with a lot of us who are in God. Certain circumstances and situations come our way, we forget what the word of God says. We forget what God says about our lives. We forget about the promises. We forget that he's all powerful, all seeing, and all knowing. We become afraid. Now, if the truth be told, it's just a normal reaction because we are flesh. And a lot of times our flesh is telling our spirit, ain't no way this is going to happen. Ain't no way you're going to be healed from this. There's no way you're going to be delivered from that. There's no way you're going to overcome this or that. And because it does not look like it, it don't seem like we're going to get the victory, we believe that we won't. So Saul was afraid. And he pitched in Shunem. And he gathered all Israel together. And they pitched at Gilboa. They came into a place together. They set up camp together. And God allowed Saul to see the Philistines gather. And he got scared. He went to the priest. And in those days, the priest looked for or seek the will of God through Urim and Thummim. And this was lights and perfection. And what these lights did was they were on the breastplate of the priest. And when they would light up to let them know what the will of God is. Now, God would not answer Saul at all because Saul had been very disobedient to God. No matter what God told Saul to do or how God told him to do it, Saul wanted to do things his own way. Does that sound like any one of you out there?
Yeah.
He inquired of the Lord, and the Lord didn't answer. He wouldn't talk to him in dreams. He wouldn't speak to him in visions. He wouldn't speak to the prophets. He wouldn't speak to him at all. And you know, I know a lot of people get angry when they come to church. And for some reason, if it's a message preached, and it happens to hit on something that's going on in your life, you get mad at the preacher. Get mad at the person next to you because you think they told the preacher. They're telling all my business. I'm not going there anymore. That don't make no sense. They sit around talking about people in church. Even her should say, ouch. Because we come into the house of the Lord to be corrected, to get guidance, to get on the right track with God. But I don't care if my dirty laundry gets aired out there. Okay, well, I should have used Clorox on my sheets. You wouldn't have saw the spots. So Saul decides, I'm going to go seek somebody who speaks to the dead because I want them to call up Samuel. Samuel was a prophet in those days, and Samuel was really fond of Saul. And he did everything he could to make sure that Saul did the right thing. He told him, just do this and just wait for me. Wait until I return and then I'll let you know what the Lord says. But he took too long in coming. So Saul decided to take matters in his own hands. And some of us do that a whole lot.
Amen.
God takes too long. I prayed for this yesterday. I expected it to happen 5 minutes after I prayed and it didn't, so I give up.
No.
Come on now.
So I'm going to try to work it out myself.
Amen.
I'm going to take matters into my own hands. Or else I'm going to go talk to the dead.
Yeah, yeah.
And the dead could be some unholy person.
Yeah.
Some ungodly person. Some deaf and dumb person. And I don't mean deaf and dumb because of the ears and because of the mouth. I'm talking about deaf and dumb in knowledge and wisdom.
Yeah, yeah.
Come on, yeah.
The Bible told us to seek godly counsel.
Yeah.
He said, in the multitude of counselors, there is safety.
Yeah.
So I try to go around people that's going to tell me the right thing.
Amen.
Going to tell me the truth, even if it hurts. Yeah, we don't like that way. It's too fuzzy. Oh, well. I decided to put it on.
Amen.
And if you don't like it, buy me one that you like.
Amen.
Saul had done away or got rid of all the witches in Israel. All the witches around, he got rid of. But how many of you know that we don't always get rid of everything?
Yeah.
Even when God tells us to come out from amongst them and be ye separate, touch not the unclean thing that I may receive you unto myself. That's the first thing we do. We gather some stuff and hold on to it.
Amen.
Making provisions for the flesh. Romans tell us don't make no provisions for the flesh. See, I know that when I was on the other side, well, I still kind of got it, but I had a bad anger problem. And I pull out a weapon in a minute, especially a knife. And then I came and had Bible study one day because God had dealt with me about having provisions for the flesh. So I told the church, I got to make a confession. Let me empty out my purse and show y'all something. Got a table full of knives, all different sizes, shapes, and colors. I said, what I wasn't realizing, what God was helping me to know was that my flesh was making provisions for my flesh. So just in case, well, we didn't go say just in case because we know how the enemy works. The enemy already had something set up that you
Yeah.
Then you're going to take your witness, and you'll probably be in penitentiary singing hymns and trying to go to the chaplain to be on the chaplain board. Then having prayer meetings in the dorm, you know, in the middle. I'm a preacher.
Tell him to him.
That was none left but one. One witch that he had saved up to the side. He said, yeah, that's one. Witch in Endor. So Saul disguises himself. And that's what a lot of us do. We don't want people to see what we're really doing behind closed doors. Yeah, right. I'm going to put on my priestly suit.
Yeah.
I'm going to put on my priestly band. I'm going to put on my priestly, my garments to look like I'm going to tuck my Bible up under my arm. And I'm going to walk around with my Bible scriptures. But deep on the inside, I got something tucked away.
Yeah.
So he had that witch in there and he said, let me go disguise myself. I'm going to look like one of y'all. I'm going to act like one of y'all. But deep on the inside, all I'm trying to do is get some information. Sometimes you got to watch out for the enemy.
Amen.
Right. And we love to be friendly with the come on in, and I'm going to tell you all my secrets and all my business. And the enemy takes those pearls. He tramples over them. Tear you apart with it. Use it against you. All your secrets are on Facebook now. Everybody reading about it. When you turn it up in the club and they showed you with the drink.
Yeah.
How did they get that picture? Because this was your friend that you confided in. Who was not of the world, not of God. Wasn't walking with God, not even thinking about it, but they told you that. So he went, and he found the witch of Endor, disguised himself and walked in. Then he asked the witch, hey, I need you to pull up somebody for me. He said, who do you need me to pull up? I want you to bring up Samuel. And as he said that, when the woman saw Samuel, when the woman saw Samuel coming up out of the ground, she knew immediately, you were Saul. You tricked me. Said, well, what do you see coming up? He said, I see a man in a cloak. I see him. He described Saul. She described Samuel to a T. So what I come to tell you right now is watch how you call up these spirits. You think you're talking to your dead mama. You think you're talking to your dead grandma. You think you're talking to your dead brother or sister. But what you did was pull up a familiar spirit and you done opened a portal to hell. He told us for a reason not to consult the dead. Don't go to mediums. He didn't say you can't talk to them because you wouldn't be able to. But there's a chance you won't be talking to mama. You won't be talking to grandma. So we're sitting in the room talking to brother. And I miss you so much. Don't say everything that you want him to say. But then in the end, when he gets you trapped in, he's going to have you doing stuff that you shouldn't be doing. And when Samuel came up, he asked Saul, why did you call me up? He said, I sought the Lord. I went through the priests. I went to prophets. I went through Urim and Thummim. But God never spoke to me. So you done messed up again. Say, at this time tomorrow, you and your sons are going to be with me. Now let me tell you something about that story. The Bible says when a child of God dies, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. They're not coming back. So what he was talking to was a demon, and he said, this time tomorrow, you're going to be with me in hell. Mm. So when you play with fire, you'll get burned.
Talk.
You got to be careful what you touch and what you play with. I'm watching, there's a lot of people that's messing with these Ouija boards because you want to find out your future. Your future is in this Bible.
Talk.
He says, my plan is to give you a hope in the future and not to harm you. My plan is to give you an expected end. But we play with fire all the time. There are many people that fall in love, but that person don't love you back. So they go find out from the old wives and the old witches and whatever, what can I do to make him love me? Get some of his clothing, get some of his hair, get some of this, and go and put it here and put it there and pray over this and pray over that. Pray the witchcraft prayer over it. If I can't get a person to love me on their own, I don't need your love. That's manipulation, and you play it with fire and you're going to get burnt. I'd rather a person love me for real and love me for who I am and love me from their heart, because that bitch will backfire on you. Made provisions for the flesh. And he used something that he thought he had hidden that caused him to believe. God warns us in the Levitical laws not to consult the mediums, don't talk to the dead. He says it for a reason. And I know a lot of you, this message is probably going straight over your head. Mm. But I'm going to tell you like this. I know when God gives a word, he gives it for a reason. Amen. And just like when the mailman comes to your house and through your neighborhood, sometimes he passes up your house because he doesn't have any mail for you. Sometimes you go in your mailbox and it says, occupant or resident. It wasn't for you. So every time he comes out, the mail might not be for you.
Yeah.
But I bet you better hold on to that letter.
Hey.
Hey. Because God is equipping us and getting us ready for what the enemy is going to do. Because see, right now, somebody is going to open up a portal to hell.
Yeah.
And there are demons roaming all around this earth. And they're waiting to get us. They're disguised. And anything or anybody that comes to you, if they are not saying the word of God, you better not believe. You better tuck tail.
Amen.
After the death comes the judgment. When the rich man and Lazarus were together, the Bible says that Lazarus desired the food, the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. He wouldn't give him a bite to eat. He wouldn't give him nothing. He laid down on the floor, had sores all over his body. The dogs licked his sores. But when they died, the rich man went to hell. And Lazarus went to heaven. And Lazarus, the rich man saw Lazarus in the bosom of Abraham. And he said, man, I'm tormented down here. He said, if you could just have Lazarus to dip his finger in some cool water and put it on my tongue, I am hot down here.
Yeah.
He said, you just send him. I have brothers back home that are not doing right. You could just send them back to talk to them, to warn them. They'll listen to him. He said, if they won't listen to the prophets, if they wouldn't listen to Moses, they sure won't listen to somebody dead that comes back. The act of disobedience caused King Saul and his sons a one-way trip to hell. When people can't get their way, when they can't get things to go their way, or how they think they should go, when they can't control people, when they can't get people to do what they want them to do, some even go as far as using control. Manipulation.
Mm-hmm.
Which way? To try to make that person conform to their will, their desires, and their ways. I've heard many stories of a lot of people that tried that. And they were told by old wives that you take their clothing or whatever and you hide it or you do whatever and you pray over it. And eventually, down the line, although they may have had that man for a while, down the line, that man, something went wrong with him. Why? Because you're messing with demons. And that man turned around and killed him. Because he went crazy. Played with fire. You get burned.
Yeah.
We can't pray. Witchcraft prayers. Prayers to control people. Lord, make him love me, Lord.
Yeah.
Touch his heart and make him love me, God. Make him stop in his tracks where he is, God. Make him leave this and that, Lord. Make him come to me, God. That's witchcraft.
Yeah.
You ask God to make him submit to his will.
Team.
And if his will ain't you, then so be it. God has something better for you. We're always thinking of ways to outsmart God, to go around God's system, God's rules, God's laws, trying to manipulate God, saying one thing, but your heart is somewhere else. You say, yo, your people honor me with your lips, but your heart is somewhere else. How will you know they are my disciples? You know by the love that they have towards one another. If you love me, you're not going to try to hurt me.
Yeah.
If you love me, you're not going to try to control me. If you love me, you're not going to try to manipulate me. Because you want me to be in the will of God. A lot of people, regardless of what you try to tell them, and you tell them over and over, you pray, you study God's word, and you know what God did in your life. If you want to be blessed, if you want to have peace, this is what worked for me. This is what I did. I read the scripture and I did what God said and it happened for me. You do it that way. That's taking too long. I'm not sitting down. I'm not tired of reading the whole Bible. I'm not going to read all that stuff. Let me go to the Chinese buffet and get me a fortune cookie. And what the fortune cookie say? Hey! He said that I'm going to help. If you want to be a friend, you got to be friendly.
Amen.
So if you're an evil person, you got a fortune cookie that says you're going to have a bunch of friends, where at? People say, hey, don't go down that dark alley. It's dangerous down there. Man, how many horror pictures you make? All the white people are always, they always get caught up in something. Oh, there's a thing that says danger, keep out. People are getting killed in here. Come on, Bobby. This is going to And no matter what God keeps telling us, he says, don't do this, don't do that, stay away from this. No, come on, Bobby. Let's go in there. Then when we get all caught up, God, where you at? Where you? Where was God when I was hurting? Who told you to go in that dark alley? You wouldn't have been hurting. Who told you to mess with that man who had 19 women? And 55 kids. Well, I know I can make him love me. We'll sing the Brady Bunch to him all day. Proverbs 26 and 17 says, like one who grabs a stray dog by the ears is someone who melts into quarrels or situations that's not his or has nothing to do with him. A lot of us get into situations that don't have nothing to do with him. We're trying to go in and be the savior for our loved ones. I'm gonna save him. Here I am to save the day. No, you're not. And we are all in God's way. He said, get out of my way. I am trying to fix it. You can't fix it. I need to fix you. No, I got this going. There was a man who was walking on a cold day. There was snow all over the place. It was freezing cold. The man had to wrap himself up. So as he was walking and freezing, he looked down on the ground. And there was a snake frozen. And he looked at the snake. Oh, I feel so sorry for him. So he picked up the frozen snake and he put it inside of his coat to warm him up. And the snake began to thaw out. And when he thawed out, the snake bit him. So as the man lay dying on the ground, he asked the snake, "Why did you bite me? I saved your life. I took you into my own bosom and warmed you up and brought you back to life. Why did you bite me?" He said, "You knew I was a snake when you picked me up. So some of you, no matter what you do, when you picked me up." So I say to one, and I say to all, don't touch the hot stove. It'll burn you. Don't go into that dark alley. It's dangerous. You don't know what's in there. Don't mess with the occult. Don't try to do witchcraft. Don't pray unrighteous prayers over people. Don't try to take vengeance yourself. Because the Lord said, "Vengeance is mine, and I will repay with tribulation those that trouble you." Yes, we get hurt. Yes, people hurt us. Yes, people take advantage of us. Yes, people misuse you. But he said, "Blessed are you when they persecute you, when they speak every hour of evil against you. Blessed are you." Because God can turn that situation around. And he's going to fix it. But he said, don't rejoice when you see your enemy getting their punishment. Because I'll stop what I'm doing. So that's why we always have to say, "Lord, just have mercy. Have mercy on me, Lord." Even Jesus, when he was on the cross, they had beaten him for no reason, stripped him naked, beat him with a cat of nine tail whip that was and ripping out the skin in his body. He had a crown of thorns over his head. Blood just everywhere. And see, what you don't know, yeah, those pictures at the Catholic Church show him with a little towel or whatever around him, but he was naked. And the only thing that covered him up was the clots of blood that was flowing from his body. But yet, in all of that, even before he said, they said, "Well, you, why don't you save yourself?" He said, "Don't you know I can call for 12 legions of angels? I can stop this at any time." But he said, "If I do, you won't get saved." Amen. So he didn't just do it for me. He just didn't do it for the ones who were trying to live right. He did it for the sinner, because he said, "I didn't want those that are already well. I came for those who needed them. I came for those that are sick. I came for those that are lost." But in all that, in all his glory and all his power, he still turned and said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." If they really knew who you were in God, they'd be right up under you. Oh, please pray for me. Please, please pray. I just want to be around you. Just show me what to do.
Amen.
So keep doing good.
Amen.
For in due season, you will reap.
Thank you, God.
If you don't give up.
Amen.
Amen. That's the message for the day.
Thank you.
grab a hold of how good God really is.
Amen.
You know, a lot of times we look at the situation that we're in. I don't have this, I don't have that, I can't do this, I don't look like that, I don't. And we let that hold us up. I don't have enough education, I didn't finish school, I got felonies on my back. Let me tell you about a felony. I'm a felon.
Amen.
And I know that the world says that, oh, you can't get the best jobs. I got to go to the felony job place so I can get a job for felons. But see, my hope and my trust is in God.
Amen.
Because I know that the enemy meant it for evil against me.
Thank you.
But everything that happened in my life, God meant it for my good.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was hurt. I was in abusive relationships. I was on drugs.
Thank you, Jesus.
I wasn't always the best person. Used to get into street fights, praise the Lord. Get into street fights because I was angry, because I was hurting. And then finally I used to break into houses. I would break into your back door while you coming in through the front door. But I never got caught for the stuff that I did. Never got caught with drugs, never got caught dealing drugs, never got caught smoking them, never got caught in the crack house. Every time I left, the police came afterwards. The people was beginning to think I was undercover or working with the police. But when I went to prison for something I didn't do. But you know, in all that, I never complained. I never said anything. I didn't blame God. I just said, well, I'm going to take this time and I'm going to study my word.
Amen.
I read my Bible from Genesis to Revelation over and over again until the devil said, I'm sick of her. Praying for people. People would come for prayer, come for counseling. And God gave me favor in that place. He even showed me that I was going to be there in a dream. I saw it. I worked for the chaplain in which I went to church 7 days a week. But when I got out, I was like, where am I going to go from here? Because I had to start all over. All over. Just getting back on my feet because I had just gotten back with the Lord. And what am I going to do? But I happened to meet a girl in jail there who she says she's a manager in some apartment complexes. And she said, when you get out, look me up. Soon as I got out, I looked her up. And she made me a manager at the apartment complex. I had a one-bedroom apartment, put me and all my kids and my grandkids in that one-bedroom apartment. I got ridiculed. I got talked about. My own pastor told me that I need to get a sign that said, we'll work for food. But I didn't give up. I kept going. I kept believing. People called me all kinds of names. They tried to destroy and assassinate my character. But I kept standing strong. I went to look for a job, and it was hard at first after I left the apartment complex, but then I went to this temporary agency. And I happened to meet with a lady named BJ, and she was saved. Said, there's a job opening at a plumbing company. They need a manager. Not once did I say in my mind, I'm not going to get this. I said, I'm going to get this. So she said, let me pray with you before you go on that interview tomorrow. When she prayed for me on the phone, I felt the power of God hit me and I almost passed out. I knew then that God had opened the door for me. And when I got there and I went to my interview, I said, you might as well take your sign down because here's your manager right here. And I stayed there for 5 years. You can't tell me what God can do. What the enemy did for evil against you, if all the odds are against you, God is better than anything. That's why we have the final say so in our lives.
Amen. Thank you.
But if I never knew that before, I sure knew it then.
Amen.
And even when God told me to start a church, and I know some of y'all saying, I wish that she would just shut up for a minute, but no, I'm going to tell my testimony. God said, I want you to take your den. Now, my den, let me start. I had to move to my own house. God opened the door for me to have a house. So, and let me tell you about the house. I was staying in some apartments, and I was looking at the house every day. I said, man, I wouldn't mind having that house. And one of the guys who was a smoker, when I got ready to move in the house, he said, you know, God was getting this house ready for you.
Amen.
They helped me to move myself from the apartment to the house.
Amen.
He said, we didn't want to put the bricks up. God said this house was for you.
Amen.
So while in that house, I had a bin, and I had bin furniture and everything up in there. God said, empty it out, and I want you to make a sanctuary. I said, God, I can't, because I went to churches and I saw how they were doing the people, and I said, I would never do God's people like that. Never! Never! So he said, if you build it, they'll come. So God said, I want you to pastor this church. I'm like, I know, I'm not hearing God right. Okay, who can I get? I got to get a man. Come on, let me get a man to pastor this church, because ain't no way that nobody's going to receive a woman pastor. Ability to hear. This building was that little part right there. And then God been extending it to this. So you can't tell me what God can do. I can hear the encouragement you want to take, no matter what it looks like, no matter what it sounds like, no matter what it feels like, no matter what it seems like, you can't do. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you.
Thank you.
you're not sure if you would go home with him. So you're dealing with some things and doing some things you know you shouldn't be doing. Hanging with some people that you should not be hanging with, and you're vexing your spirit and you can't understand why. Sleepless nights, worry, stress, depression. Come let us pray with you and for you.
Proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen.